So today we are going to see Tucker's lemma, which is also known as a discrete version of Borsuk-Ulam theorem. Okay, so we will start with the exact theorem statement for this lemma, and then we'll do a reformulation of it and show how it gives the proof of a Borsuk-Ulam theorem. And later at the end, we will show how Tucker's lemma can be proved. Okay, so the main goal for this piece is to prove Borsuk-Ulam theorem from Tucker's lemma. Okay, and this involves two steps. First being that we show Borsuk-Ulam theorem is equivalent to the Tucker's lemma. The version which we would use is the BU2B, which to recall is that there is no continuous mapping F from Bn to Sn minus 1, which is antipodal on the boundary of Bn. Okay, and then in the second step, we'll use the language of chains and boundaries and prove the Tucker's lemma itself. So the equivalence of Borsuk-Ulam theorem and Tucker's lemma together with the proof of Tucker's lemma will give a proof of Borsuk-Ulam theorem from the Tucker's lemma. Okay, so for the step one, let's do the basic machinery. Let T be a finite triangulation of the n-dimensional ball. Okay, triangulation on the Bn is said to be antipodally symmetric. It is said to be antipodally symmetric on the boundary of Bn if for every simplex of Sn minus 1, which is in the triangulation, minus sigma is also there. Okay, so this can be achieved through a lot of finer and finer divisions into the triangulation. So given any triangulation, you can keep on triangulating it further and further to achieve this sort of a triangulation. Okay, and we will say that some triangulation is on Bn is antipodally symmetric if for any sigma a simplex in that triangulation, minus sigma is also a simplex. Example, for B2, if I take this filled ball, okay, and I just take these four two cells as my facets. So this first quadrant, second quadrant, third quadrant, and fourth quadrant. If you see something like this as your triangulation of Bn, then on the boundary, you see this particular zigzag sort of a line. If let's say this is your tau, then minus tau is here. If this is your sigma, minus sigma is here. If this was your sigma, this is your minus sigma. And for this as sigma, this is minus sigma. So for all the points of Sn minus 1, or rather all the subspaces of Sn minus 1, which form which gives a simplex, the minus of that is also a simplex. Okay, so for this, this is there. For this is there, and so on. And to see when something like this may not be a good way, so if let's say you have triangulated your B2 using the three cells of this kind, yeah, so don't see it through these x and y axis which I've drawn in between. Rather, see that you will have a center point here as a, let's say, barycenter, or so in center for this particular circle, and then you have these three facets. So then on the boundary, you have exactly three many one cells, this zigzag line, this dotted line, and this Brownian motion line. But this is not a antipodally symmetric triangulation of Bn, which would be antipodally symmetric on Sn minus 1. Because for this, for instance, there is no minus. Its minus would have been somewhere like this, but that's not a simplex. Okay. So, further machinery, we say assuming some triangulation of Bn and some signed weightage function lambda, which is defined from the vertex set of this triangulation to the set n union minus n. So recall this square bracket n just means the set 1 to n, 1 up to n, the natural numbers 1, 2, 3, 4 up to n, union minus of this. So this set is plus minus 1, plus minus 2, and so on up till plus minus n. Okay. So a function like this is, I am naming it as signed weightage function, because to each vertex of T, which is a triangulation, it is assigning a weight, and that weight is of signed nature. It can be either positive or negative. Okay. So once you have a signed weightage function defined from a triangulation of BN, a one simplex of T is called a complementary edge if its vertices are labeled by opposite numbers. Okay. So if, let's say, you have a edge XY in T such that X has labeling minus J and Y has labeling J, then that will be called a complementary edge. There is an example in the book to see if, let's say, this is your B2 and this is a triangulation of B2, then this is a complementary edge because its endpoints are labeled by opposite numbers, plus 2 and minus 2. Okay. Further, now we are in a position to define the Tucker's lemma, the actual version. So this says that if T is a triangulation of BN that is antipodally symmetric on its boundary, and you have a signed weightage function on VT such that it respects the antipodality on the boundary of BN, then there is a complementary edge in T. Okay. So to understand this, what it is really saying is that if you start with a triangulation of BN, which is antipodally symmetric on the boundary, and you have a signed weightage function which respects this antipodalities on the BN, then you have a complementary edge in the triangulation that you started with. Okay. But this version is not very handy to work with. So we'll have a different version of it. For that, let's just go to some things which we have already seen in the past. So let delta n minus 1 be an abstract simplicial complex whose vertex set is this set, plus minus 1, plus minus 2, up to plus minus n. And any subset of this vertex set is going to form a simplex if for no I in this, I and minus I both belongs to this set F, which is same as saying that F intersection minus F has to be empty. Okay. So first of all, you can check that delta N minus 1 gives a triangulation of SN minus 1. Okay. Okay. So this is one of the exercises for this week's assignment. And now we see a reformulation for the Tucker's lemma. So starting with the same, let T be a triangulation of BN that is antipodally symmetric on its boundary. Then there is no map lambda from the vertex set of T to the vertex set of this simplicial complex that is both a simplicial map as well as antipodal on the boundary. Okay. So this should be easy to observe that both the versions. So just notice the symbol here. This is a dagger sort of a symbol. And this is star, that these two are equivalent. Using this complementary edge is same as what should give you the antipodality contradiction here. Okay. So that is easy to check. You do that. And now we come to the first step, which says, which asks for we will use these both these statements interchangeably and prove the Borsuk-Ulam theorem from it. Okay. So, as I already said, to complete this step, now we'll show the equivalence between the 2B version of the Borsuk-Ulam theorem along with this dagger slash star. So it should be easy to observe that if you assume this and you start with any triangulation of the BN, which is antipodal on the boundary, then since you know that it cannot have a, I mean, you can do this by contrapositivity and that is going to be super easy. So not star implies not BU to B, which is same as in saying BU to B implies star. So this is the direction which is more important, starting from here going to here. So to do this, let's assume that F from BN to SN minus 1 is a continuous map that is antipodal on BN. Okay, so we are starting with a contradiction if possible, and we'll now choose our triangulation of BN very carefully. And what we really do is we say that let T to be a triangulation of BN which is antipodal on the boundary and has simplex diameter less than delta. How we choose this delta, let's see. To start with, set epsilon to be 1 by root n. Then for any y in the Sn minus 1, its infinity norm is greater than or equal to epsilon y. First, just see what was infinity norm. Infinity norm is the maximum value of mod yi. Okay? So if all the modulus yi's are less than epsilon, then their square summation is going to be strictly less than epsilon because epsilon is less than 1, right? So if yi is less than epsilon, then yi square is further lesser than epsilon. And when you add all these up, you're not going to reach 1 ever. So at least one of the coordinates have to have, one of the coordinates of this vector y has to have a value strictly bigger than at least epsilon. And since f is a function which is defined on a compact set, it is uniformly continuous. Therefore, you have a delta such that whenever distance between any two points x and x prime is less than delta, the distance between fx and fx prime is less than 2 epsilon, the infinity norm distance. Okay, we choose this particular delta which we get you because of these conditions that we have in hand. So we choose this particular delta to get the simplex diameter for this triangulation which we want to define on our BN, with of course these extra properties that it should be antipodal on the boundary of BN. Yeah, now we define a signed weightage function. That is the another requirement which we have for the Tucker's lemma. So to do this, let us first see that if you have FV is actually going from here to here. It's a function which takes an n vector to an n vector, correct? So in the vector language, I am putting this subscript here to denote that it is at the ith coordinate. So ith coordinate of the vector FV in Sn minus 1. Okay, since I know that every point of Sn minus 1 satisfies this, I know that there is going to be a point for which F of Vi is going to peak up the epsilon. I choose minimum such Vi for which the modulus value is bigger than equal to epsilon, and I define that to be KV. Now using this KV, we define this So lambda v is defined to be positive of kv if the fv has the value positive at this particular coordinate, and minus of kv if the value was negative. Okay, so that, see, it's clear that kv can range only from 1 to n. So these are the values from minus n to n, the integer values, excluding 0. Yeah, it does not hit 0. Okay, and since f is known to be antipodal on the boundary of Bn, it is clear that if I choose any point on the boundary and I take negative of that, lambda of minus of v is going to be minus of lambda of v for any point of the boundary of Bn. Okay, so then by the Tucker's lemma, this is going to give me a complementary edge, say vw. Complementary edge, remember, vw means that lambda on v is going to be exactly negative of lambda of w. Okay, let's go back to that diagram. Complementary edge means a one-dimensional simplex whose endpoints are labeled opposite to each other. So same number but opposite sign. Okay, so I get a complementary edge by Tucker's lemma, vw. So lambda v is minus of lambda w. Let this to be equal to I. And without loss of generality, I can say I is positive. Because one of these numbers anyway have to be positive, either lambda v or lambda w. Right? Because lambda of any point can't hit zero. This is how it is defined. And kv can take minimum value to be one. So if lambda of v is I, which is positive, lambda of w is minus I, and that is negative. And since lambda v is positive, I know that lambda v would be plus of kv, because kv's are always positive. Correct? This would imply that fv at the coordinate kv was positive. From the definition of lambda, plus kv appears when the fv at kvth location was positive. So fv of kv is positive, and fv of I is greater than or equal to epsilon, because that is what kv records. Correct? Kv is exactly the I where f of v is greater than or equal to epsilon. So you have this. Similarly, f of wi is less than or equal to minus epsilon, because lambda of w is going to be minus of kv, which is going to give me that fw at kw is less than zero. So f of wi is less than or equal to minus epsilon. But now with these two points, v and w, I already know vw is a h, right? So since t has simplex diameter delta, distance between v and w is less than delta, right? And since the distance between v and w is less than delta, the infinite norm distance between fv and fw should be less than 2 epsilon. However, here when you see norm of fv minus fw, infinity norm is actually bigger than equal to 2 epsilon, because this is strictly bigger than epsilon, and this is bigger than equal to epsilon, and this is less than equal to minus epsilon. So this is greater than equal to 2 epsilon, which is a contradiction, right? So we have seen that Tucker's lemma is equivalent to the Borsuk-Ulam theorem version 2b. We have already seen that all the versions of Borsuk-Ulam theorem are equivalent. Now we will come to the next part, which proves the Tucker's lemma itself. So for this, we again need some basics. So this is mainly about the chain maps and boundaries. So if you guys are familiar about it, you can skip this part. The proof we'll see possibly in the next lecture, depending on how long this lecture gets. but who haven't seen, let's just stay with me. So for a simplicial complex X, a K chain is a set CK of K dimensional simplices of X. Okay. So this K can be anything from zero up till the dimension of X. Okay. And see, I am not saying that CK is the collection of all the K simplices. I am saying that a K chain is a set of K dimensional simplices. Not all the K dimensional simplices. Some K dimensional simplices, if they are put together, it's called a K chain. That's it. So you can have a zero chain, which consists of, so some zero chain will be some, let's say C0, that is going to consist of just the vertices of the simplicial complex X. If you have a one chain, it is going to consist of edges. If you're going to have a two chain, it is going to consist of many, many triangles, and so on. Empty K chain is denoted by zero. We don't use the empty symbol here. Verify, that's not we are using. We'll denote it by zero. Okay. Why we'll do that? That's also will be clear when we do the addition, etc. We want to make sense of it. So if let's say you have two K chains, what can you do with them? You can add them. And how is addition done? Given two K chains, CK and DK, the CK plus DK is again a K chain, and it is defined as the symmetric difference of CK and DK. Okay. So if let's say CK has some R many K chains and DK has some N many K chains, and there are few common chains in it, common simplices in it, K dimensional simplices, then they sort of cancel out. So only the odd ones survive. The simplices that appear odd number of times would survive. Okay, so it's a symmetric difference. So in particular, CK plus CK will always be zero, because every simplex here will have a twin sitting here. So it will become twice of that particular simplex, and that way every simplex will cancel out, and the CK plus CK will give me zero. If F is a K dimensional simplex, so in this simplicial complex X, if F is a K dimensional simplex, then boundary of F, which means what we know as of now are facets, right? In the chains language, we say that boundary of F is the K minus one chain. So clearly, if F is a K dimensional simplex, its facets are going to be K minus one dimensional simplices. So it's a K minus one chain, which consists of the facets of F, canonically enough. So delta half F has exactly K plus one many K minus one dimensional simplices. Okay. And for a K chain CK, let's say it has m many simplices of dimension k, f1, f2, fm, the boundary is defined to be the summation of boundaries of each of these simplexes. Okay, for one simplex, it is defined to be the k minus one chain, which has all of these facets. Okay. And if you have a K chain that itself has more than one simplices, then its boundary is defined as summation of all of these facets. Again, this sum is taken modulo 2. So it contains those K minus one dimensional simplices that occur in odd number of times as facets of Fi's and Ck, as I've already explained while taking this summation. So same routine follows. Okay. Two more properties that are needed for the from the chain complexes, etc., are that if you add two chains, K chains, and apply the boundary operator, it distributes over this, which means delta of CK plus DK is same as delta of CK plus delta of DK. And boundary operator applied on boundary of CK is zero for any K chain. Okay, both of these are also exercises. You are supposed to do them. Now, let f from k to l be a simplicial map, then any such simplicial map, once you have, of course, for this k, you will have k chains. For this l, you will have l chains. K chains. So given any particular k, as far as the dimension is fine, this f induces a f hash k, a function on the k chains, ck k to ck l, sending k chains of k to k chains of l. Okay? If ck is, so this contains all the k chains now. Okay, I've put a bracket and I'm using the simplex inside, simplicial complex inside. This is containing all these simplicity, all the k chains of k. This contains all the k chains of l. So if let's say ck is an element here, maybe I could have written a small ck. If that is just a simplex, then this f hash k is defined to be the f of f. If it is just a simplex, it's a simplex of k itself. And this being a simplicial map, I know that f of f is going to be a simplex here, right? So f of f forms a simplex, and that is how the f hash k of ck is defined. And it is zero otherwise. And I can extend this linearly to any k chain. So if let's say I have a k chain with m many elements, m many k dimensional simplices, then f hash of ck, as one would expect, is f hash of f1, f2, fm. You linearly spread it out. So f hash k of f1 plus f hash k of f2 and so on up till f hash k of fm. Again, this addition happens modulo 2. Okay. One can check that this boundary operator commutes with the k-chain maps which are induced from any simplicial map. What that means is that if you start with a k-chain ck, apply the boundary operator. Remember that boundary operator sends any k-chain to a k-1 chain. So delta of ck is going to be a k-1 chain. So on that, when you apply the f hash of k minus 1, I'm putting a bar just to mean that it is a one number instead of k and minus 1 being different numbers. So applying f hash of k minus 1 on this k minus 1 chain is same as applying the f hash k on the k chain ck and then taking the boundary operator. So f hash k of ck is going to be a k chain. And on that k chain, if you apply your boundary operator, this k minus 1 chain is actually same as this k minus 1 chain. So that is why we say that these two operations commute with each other. Okay, and this is true for any k chain, any k and any k chain. Now we turn back to the proof of the Tucker's lemma. Maybe some more material is needed. I'll do that and stop. So if you have, starting with k to be any number from 0, 1 up to n minus 1, we define hk plus and hk minus for each of these k. How do we define it? Hk plus is defined to be those vectors of Sn minus 1 for which xk plus 1 is greater than or equal to 0 and all higher indices are exactly equal to 0. Similarly, for hk minus is the collection of all those vectors of Sn minus 1 such that xk plus 1 is less than or equal to 0 and xk plus 2 onwards, all xi's are 0. So in the picture, if you would want to see, let's say on the sphere I am, so my k is 2, or rather, so just remember, maybe I should... okay, so from here itself, see that given any dimensional n here, if you have h0, you're saying that h1 is greater than or equal to 0 and H2, H3, and all other Xi's are zero. If you take this, Xk plus 1, which is X1, is less than or equal to 0. Rest all are 0. So it is easy to see that H0 plus is going to be, if let's say I am in my S2, then H0 plus is the 100. Okay. And H0 minus is going to be minus, comma, 0, comma, 0. Right? On the x-axis, the points which you have. Then, if you try to see it from the up, then H2 plus gives you all the points which are above the equator, sort of. And H2 minus are going to give exactly the opposite points on the bottom. H1 is going to be on the equator of this, or rather the intersection of H2 plus and H2 minus. And this is all formalized and written here. So Hn minus 1 plus and Hn minus 1 minus are the northern and southern hemispheres of Sn minus 1. Okay, because what you're saying is you take the topmost number to be greater than or equal to 0. And there is no condition on any of the other points. So you are just hitting the northern hemisphere. For Hn minus 1 of minus, you are saying that Xn to be less than or equal to 0, and there is no restriction on any other Xi. So that is exactly the southern hemisphere. If you come one dimension lower, then Hn minus 2 plus union Hn minus 2 minus is the n minus 2 dimensional equator. Okay, so this equator, say you can see this as the great circle which we know for any Sn, the great circle, and then for that lower dimension again the great circle, and so on. So you keep on coming one dimension down and you get these equators. And also this is actually the intersection of these two. Okay, and so on. Hn minus 3 plus union Hn minus 2 minus is going to be the n minus 3 dimensional equator, and that space is actually the Hn minus 2 plus intersection of Hn minus 2 minus. Similarly, you keep on coming down, H0 plus union H0 minus is the lowest possible equator, or just the pair of antipodal points which is obtained from H1 plus intersection H1 minus, right? See in this picture itself. So this was my H2 plus, this is my H2 minus, this intersection is this space here, which is your H1 plus, and this is, sorry, H1 minus, and this piece is H1 plus. Their intersection is H0 plus and H0 minus, right? So once we have seen the structure of HK plus and HK minus for any Sn minus 1, we now proceed further. So remember I said that we'll use all the structure to prove the Tucker's lemma in complete combinatoriality. So the extra restriction that we want on the triangulation T is that for any Hi plus Hi minus, there should be subcomplexes of T which are triangulating them. Okay, so what this really says is that you should be able to break the triangulation of T into all these pieces, all these northern, southern hemispheres, all these equators, so that antipodally it is way too symmetric. Okay. So that is the additional restriction that we are asking for. And that is also not hard to see. This is achievable again by doing, because once you already know that the function is antipodally symmetric on the boundary, antipodal on the boundary of the BN, I can further triangulate it so that it is triangulating further these HI plus and HI minus for any I. Okay. So now we come to the proof of Tucker's lemma. For this proof, we may not want the lambda, the signed weightage function, to go into the delta N minus 1, which we did earlier. Okay. It is good enough if lambda goes into any antipodally symmetric triangulation L of Sn minus 1. Yeah. So this entire proof will be done in a general sense. How it is done? We'll prove another theorem, which is going to imply the Tucker's lemma. What this theorem says is that if you take T to be any triangulation of the n-dimensional ball as described above, which means T triangulates, there are subcomplexes of T which are triangulating HI plus and HI minus for every I. Okay. So if T is any such triangulation of BN and K be a antipodally symmetric part of T that triangulates Sn minus 1, which means K is the restriction of T onto the boundary of BN, right? So that is how it is going to give you the triangulation for Sn minus 1. And let F to be a simplicial map from K to L. Then, if An minus 1 is the collection of all the N minus 1 dimensional simplices of K, that means it is the full N minus 1 chain set. Remember this notation from the earlier part? We say CKK to mean all the K chains of K, all the K chains of L. Okay. So here, when I'm keeping this in the bracket, I am saying that all the K chain, all the N minus 1 chains of K, I collect and I call that set N minus 1. If that is my AN minus 1, then the N minus 1 chain BN minus 1, which is defined as the F hash N minus 1 of AN minus 1. This is again that induced map, which we get from our simplicial map. Then this is either empty or it is full of CN minus 1 L. Okay. Which means it's either the empty simplex, empty is like zero chain, empty chain, which is denoted by zero, or it contains all the N minus 1 simplices of L. In other words, what this really means is that if you're standing here, this means either every simplex, N minus 1 simplex that you have here has even number of pre-images, in which case this is going to give me empty, right? Because once you have applied this, all the addition will happen modulo 2, or all of the N minus 1 dimensional simplices of this are going to have odd pre-images. And that is when you're going to get the full this, An minus 1, right? And everything survives exactly once. So if every element has even number of pre-images, we say that degree 2 of F is 0. 2, we are taking modulo 2. And if every N minus 1 simplex has odd degree, then we write this as degree 2 F is 1. Okay? And F is said to have an odd degree. Now, let F bar be any simplicial map from VT to VL. Remember, VL is just any triangulation of Sn minus 1. Okay, antipodally symmetric triangulation of Sn minus 1. VT is that special triangulation of BN, which is defining triangulation on each of the HIs, HI plus, HI minus, such that F is the restriction of F bar, when restricted to the VK, it is F. So VK was nothing but the restriction of T onto the boundary of BN, right? If this is the case, then degree of 2 degree of F is 0, which means F has even degree. And the third point is, if F is antipodal symplegial map, then F has degree odd. Okay, so first of all, how these three conditions together will imply. So first of all, just come to the first thing. If you have taken the collection which contains all the n minus 1 simplices of the K, okay, and you apply the induced map from the simplicial map, then either it's empty or it is odd. It's full of the Cn minus 1 L, right? Which means the map F is either going to have degree even or degree odd. This much is clear from this. Now, when it is even and when it is odd is coming from these two. So if F is the restriction of F bar, where F bar is any simplicial map, then its degree is even. And if F itself is antipodal simplicial map, then its degree is odd. So now if you see the map lambda, the signed weightage function, then this is of degree even by this, because it was a simplicial map. However, it was antipodal simplicial map. Therefore, it is having degree odd also. So you have a contradiction, which means you cannot have such a lambda, right? Now, we see the proof of these three points. To see the first one, what do you really have to show? That this Dn minus 1 is either empty or full of Cn minus 1 n. Suppose not, then what? Then that tells me that there are n minus 1 dimensional simplices such that something is in Dn minus 1 and something is outside of Dn minus 1, correct? If everything is inside, then it is going to be Cn minus 1 L. If nothing is inside, then it is empty. So there is something in it and something in its complement, correct? Therefore, there are two simplices, n minus 1 dimensional simplices, such that one of them is in Dn minus 1 and the other one is not inside the Dn minus 1, where Dn minus 1 is f hash n minus 1 of Cn minus 1 k. Okay. Convince yourself, why do they share a facet? These two simplices that we are talking about, one of them being inside Dn minus 1, another being outside Dn minus 1. They share a facet. And clearly, if this facet is there as a facet of one of the simplices of Dn minus 1, then it appears in the delta of Dn minus 1, correct? So this common facet is in delta Dn minus 1. However, delta Dn minus 1 can be written as delta of f hash n minus 1 Cn minus 1 k. Cn minus 1 k is Kn minus 1. Now I apply the commutativity of delta and f hash. So I get f hash of n minus 2 of delta a n minus 1. But this is 0. Why? Because every n minus 2 simplex of k is a facet of exactly 2 n minus 1 dimensional simplices of a n minus 1. Correct? Just visualize this and you will get this. So this is a contradiction. Therefore, Dn minus 1 is either empty or full of Cn minus 1 of L. Okay. Now, to the second point, let's just go back again and see what was the second point. If F bar from Vt to Vl is any simplicial map such that F bar, when restricted to the boundary of T, is F, then the degree of F is even. Okay. This is also visually very clear, but let's just see in the language of chains and boundaries. So suppose An is Cn of T, all the n simplexes of T. Then An minus 1 is delta An. Correct? Also, F bar of f hash n bar of an is 0 because dimension of L itself is n minus 1. So you do not have anything in lower dimensions, right? Therefore, dn minus 1, which is f hash of n minus 1 of an minus 1, which can now be written as delta of f bar of hash n an, because f is restriction of f bar on an, and then f on an is f bar on an is an minus 1 is the same as f bar of on delta of an. So this is delta of 0, which is 0, which implies that degree 2 of f is 0. So f is of even degree because dn turned out to be 0. Okay. The third point, which said that if f is antipodal simplicial map, then degree of f is odd. This is the more involving part, so stay with me. Let's take some more. You might have been wondering so far, like, why we defined all those hk, etc., hk plus, hk minus, their intersections, their unions. All that will come into picture now. So define ak plus to be all the k chains of k which are in the hk plus, okay, in sort of upper hemisphere of the kth dimensional sphere. Ak minus similarly is the collection of all the k dimensional simplices of k which are in the lower dimensional hemisphere, and ak to be all of these collectively. So ak plus plus ak minus. Then for any k from 1 to n minus 1, delta ak plus is going to be same as delta of ak minus because they are antipodally symmetric, right? And this, using this definition, shows that it is going to be ak minus 1, right? So if I similarly set ck plus to be their images, respective images under f hash, so ck plus is f hash k of ak plus, ck minus is f hash k of ak minus, and ck to be ak plus plus, sorry, ck plus plus ck minus, then delta of ck plus is again delta of ck minus, and with this in picture, I see that it is ck minus 1. Now claim is that cn minus 1 is non-zero. Right? That is when I will get that the map is of odd degree. So to be consistent, cn minus 1 is actually meaning cn minus 1 of L here. Okay. So suppose not, then cn minus 1 is cn minus 1 plus plus cn minus 1 minus, which is from this definition, is going to be 0. We are starting with a contradiction, okay, as a contradictory assumption. So this is going to imply that cn minus plus is equal to cn minus minus. Now, since an minus plus is antipodal to an minus 1 minus, why? Because hk plus is always antipodal to hk minus, right? Simplices in hk plus have an antipodally symmetric simplex in hk minus. So an minus 1 plus is antipodal to an minus 1 minus, and f is also antipodal. Therefore cn minus 1 plus is also antipodal to cn minus 1 minus. Yeah. Further, since they are equal, this implies that if I define sn minus 1 to be these, then this is antipodally symmetric. Okay, so now what I do, I want to write it in terms of boundaries of these antipodally symmetric chains. Fine. So thus cn minus 2, which is the boundary of cn minus 1 plus, this we are getting from this point here. Okay, so cn minus 2 is boundary of cn minus 1 plus, which is boundary of Sn minus 1, because I set Sn minus 1 to be Cn minus 1 plus, which is same as Cn minus 1 minus. Therefore, I see that Cn minus 2 is a boundary of an antipodally symmetric chain, right? So this is the topmost chain in some sense. I want to come down and down. Okay, so we now use induction and assume that for some k positive, Ck is equal to delta of Sk plus 1 for an antipodally symmetric chain Sk plus 1, and deduce a similar claim for Sk minus 1, Ck minus 1. So I am applying reverse induction. Okay, I have for top dimension. Therefore, this is true for some k. Okay, that is the assumption. And now I'm going to prove that it is true for Ck minus 1, which means Ck minus 1, I should be able to prove to be boundary of an antipodally symmetric chain, some antipodally symmetric chain. Note that the antipodally symmetric chain Sk plus 1 can be partitioned as some Ek plus 1 and Ek plus 1 A. Since it is antipodally symmetric, I can just keep on taking simplices. Let's say I take a simplex alpha, okay? I pick its antipodally symmetric minus alpha in it. And if alpha goes to Ek plus 1, I send my alpha bar, let's say the antipodally symmetric one, into Ek plus 1 A. Okay, this way you can partition your Sk plus 1 into these two parts. Now, Ck, as was defined, is Ck plus plus Ck minus. Putting these values here, I get that Ck plus, since that was, so Ck was also the boundary of delta Sk plus 1 from the assumption, right? So I get this entire thing is equal to delta of this entire thing. Okay, so Ck is boundary of this item. Now you can do the manipulation, take this inside and play with the modulo 2 thing and get that Ck plus plus boundary of Ek plus 1 is equal to Ck minus plus boundary of Ek plus 1 antipodal. Now, since this left hand side is antipodal to right hand side, that is clear to see, right? Because this is antipodally symmetric to this, this is antipodally symmetric to this, therefore this entire K chain is antipodally symmetric to this entire K chain, antipodal chain. So I have that Sk now can be defined as Ck plus 1 plus delta of Ek plus 1, and then this is an antipodally symmetric chain. Applying delta on this Sk, we get that delta Sk is equal to delta of Ck plus plus delta of delta Ek plus 1. Okay, we have already seen from the properties of this boundary operator that double the boundary operator gives you the zero chain. So del del Ek plus 1 is going to vanish. I'm going to get delta of Sk is equal to delta of Ck plus, which is by definition Ck minus 1. Okay, and hence the induction. So I have that Ck minus 1 is also the boundary of an antipodally symmetric chain Sk. Okay, this way I proceed up till k is equal to 1, and we see that C0 is equal to boundary of an antipodally symmetric 1 chain. But C0, we already know, is a pair of antipodal points. It is just two points, the pair of antipodal points. Why I know that? Because C0, from this, if you see, even earlier. Yeah. So C0 is Ck plus and Ck minus. Ck plus is f hash k of this, and Ck minus is f hash k of this. But A0 plus is going to be just the AK, A0 plus and A0 minus are actually going to be the H0 plus and H0 minus, because those are the only points, right? And therefore, Ck is a collection of two antipodal points. That is it. However, if you take the boundary of any antipodally symmetric one chain, it will consist of an even number of antipodal pairs. You see this? Whenever you are taking boundary, and that too of an antipodally symmetric one chain, you have a symmetry. So for every simplex, you have an antipodally symmetric simplex again. And hence, its boundary will consist of even number of antipodal pairs. This gives you a contradiction because here you have just one pair and one is an odd number. Therefore, degree of F is odd. And with this, the Tucker's lemma proof is also done. Okay, thanks.